don't behave as sheep.
Excuse me, a non-profit organization whose focus is children's safety on the internet.
Yeah.
What giant piece of bullshit is that? I'm sorry if you're part of that, but I'm just curious because there I say that because all you have to do is type in the letters P-O-R-N into Google and you will see things that will that you shouldn't, okay? That you shouldn't see, right? And, oh, we're all for child safety on the internet. I'm sorry, but fail. That's like saying we want to keep the moon clean. Yeah, or you know, we want to stop interstellar static, or you know, the trees are too green, or you know, this is setting yourself an absolutely impossible task. And I know that this is nonsense because all of those organizations, all of them are like, oh, we do this for the children. It's for the kids. We have to keep the kids safe. We have to keep the... And none of them do. None of them. Zero. They have 0% success. It's madness. So
it is about education. It is about education, not making internet safe, but learning safe behavior there, and it is hard to measure it. It started some 10 years ago or long time ago.
That's like telling people don't jump off a cliff. I mean, that's just stupid, right? I mean, because if obviously there is good and bad in everything, and obviously you have to, you know, it's like saying, oh, we need to educate children about drinking alcohol, or we need to educate children about crossing roads. It's like, yes, but, you know, that's like saying we need to educate people about having two arms and two legs. It's just treating all organizations like that are treating all adults as idiots. Because they're saying that parents can't educate the children, schools can't educate the children can't educate the children, and that's nonsense, right? That's absolute nonsense. I mean, I understand teaching somebody about the intricacies of biology or chemistry or, you know, the physics of the world. I understand that, but educating people about this, it's like saying be careful, trees might fall on your head.
I'm sorry, but I have a slightly different opinion.
No, that's good. That's good, because if we had exactly the same opinion, that would be very strange. So so that's good. No, but explain to me what I am missing about the wonders of such an organization. How does this organization provide any real help or any value that doesn't take longer than 5 minutes for a sensible person?
As I have said, it is hard to measure the pros of such...
basic rules of management. If you can't measure it, it's not manageable. That's a foundation of management.
Simply, so. It is old idea, not something now progressive.
Mm-hmm. I see two potential problems there. I mean, the first problem is that you're teaching children that their parents don't know what's best for them, which creates a conflict in the mind of the child about, you know, what kind of authority they should have in their life. And you are not you personally, but people are overthinking the problem, which is, like I said, like I already explained, it's like a tree might fall on your head. You have to be careful. It's like, yeah, but, you know, it's not going to happen. And you can't avoid it. You know, when you know that you have older children buy alcohol for younger children, for example. So, you know, that's going to happen. When you know that there's a choice of things that people can do. I mean, you don't really need to educate children very much about alcohol, except to say that, you know, you drink it, it causes changes in your body, you become stupid and you fall over. And that's really, you know, the source of a lot of problems. Yeah, perhaps taken in moderation, it's fine. But, you know, that takes, what does that take? That takes 2 to 5 minutes, you know, building a whole company based out of the principle of something that takes 5 minutes to communicate to people. And if the person doesn't have a brain, if they come from a family of people who are too stupid to educate their children about these things, then what you're saying is, A, the system has failed already, and B, we're just going to perpetuate the same problem. So, you know, if these parents went to school and school had no effect on them, then you're just basically admitting that the system failed in the past, but we're going to repeat it. And repeating something which doesn't work is the basic definition of stupidity. So it's not going to make a great or grand difference in the lives of children. And you can't. And I have watched hundreds of thousands of these programs develop, and people always, well, we need to do this for the kids. It's like, well, do we want to help kids? Yes. But is it a natural thing that people do? Well, yes. And do we need to take it to the next level? Well, it's almost like saying we need to teach children how to walk. You know, it's something that they're going to encounter anyway. And if you say something, well, it's about values, well, your culture gives you your values, right? So you can't have one organization teaching one thing and then a whole culture teaching something different, because that just doesn't fit. That just creates conflict in the mind of people, especially children, because there needs to be continuity. For children to grow and develop properly, they have to understand the nature of continuity. Also, that there are different opinions. And I see part of what you're saying, I see in this idea that some parents don't educate their children very well, and perhaps things like school provide an open door of escape for intellectual young people who show skills in certain areas where they can join clubs and learn about subjects and meet other young people. But that doesn't change the fact that at least 50% of human development is genetic, and the child still has to go home at the end of the day to be with the parents. And if you're teaching the child that the parents don't know what's best, you're just telling the children that the parents are stupid. That's not going to develop a good relationship between the children and the parents. And the child in general has the same basic IQ as the parents. If it didn't, then IQs would be massively variable amongst every family and every culture. And they're not. They're the complete opposite. Therefore, it can't work.
I think that as a society, we are somehow obliged to give all children the same possibilities, same space for development. And mm-hmm. and could be somehow to save them from their parents in certain cases. At least giving them some intention, some ideas that it is possible to live the other way. I am not saying that it is perfect and functioning effectively, but opposite would be very pessimistic, very depressive, and with our share of Roma people in society, it would generate huge negative followings.
Yeah, I had a friend of a friend whose job it was to sell satellite. First, I agree with you. Okay, absolutely agree with you. Secondly, I had a friend of a friend who sold satellite televisions, and so he had all this data and all this information from his work, and he said that basically 25% of the time the gypsy populations that he sold this technology to were watching porn. 25% of the time it was it, so they're like and you can imagine like the kids would come home from school and people would just be sitting in the living room watching this, right? So yes, you do need someone to say that there's another road, there's another way, but then you're putting them in conflict with their with their culture, which is a which is an even bigger problem. And you know, we see this we see this culturally throughout society. You know, why is why are some African countries, you know, suffering from extreme economic problems? And one of the one of the main reasons is IQ. It's intelligence. That the average IQ is 70 in and less in a lot of these countries. And so people are, and this doesn't mean that people are stupid. What it means is they don't have the ability to discern and make the best judgments. It often means that they're too trusting, you know, because you know what I personally define as like stupid would be when somebody says, "Hey, can you give me 50 euros? I'll give you 500 euros back tomorrow." And you know, somebody would go, "Oh, that's a great deal, yeah." And you know, the low IQ people would be very trusting, and they would be abused because of this. The same way that I believe that there are stories of Buddhist monks who, when they leave, they spend all their life in monasteries, and then when they leave and enter the world, they want to help people, and that doesn't work very well because people take advantage of that a lot of the time. So, so there are these kinds of problems. And so, yeah, just IQ and helping populations is the single greatest problem in human history, actually. Because that's one of the foundations of conflict. That if you want to communicate with somebody who has a lower intelligence than yourself, then you have to go down to their level. You can't raise them up to yours. And this is complicated. Statistically, here's a strange fact. Statistically, since 1980, the average IQ in Britain has dropped 10 points.
Ooh.
10 points since 1980. And this is a result of the migration into the country of people from countries with lower IQs, simply. And this has...
Our Roma are there, involved.
man, I am not even going to tell you what I saw on the plane the last time I went to Scotland, right? Half of the plane was gypsies. Oof. Half of the plane. That was one plane on one day. Can you imagine if you calculate and total all of the planes on all of the days going there? Right? I mean, oh, I can't see any gypsies today. Right, well, you know, it's because they're all living off of the government cheese in other countries. And that's just simply because the people know that the gypsies will vote for whoever gives them things for free, which is the greatest failure of democracy. That a large number of people just will support whoever gives them free stuff because they don't understand that nothing is free.
Such behavior is connected with this low IQ.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And if we look at you know, cultures where that's happening, it's happening across Europe right now, and it's happening very rapidly. I say very rapidly. It's not so fast that it's really completely visible, but it's a 1% rise per year.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, the difference between 1980 and now in average British IQ. I mean, it's just 1% a year is enough that you don't notice it over a short period of time. But if you take the bigger picture, then it becomes clearly obvious what the political agenda is. Let's let in all of these foreign people with low IQ. They will vote for us. We will get back into power. And the circle will continue again and again and again. And that's why I think that there should be an ownership of property validation for those who wish to participate in political processes. You know, you would not send a group of local gypsies to the European Union to debate in Parliament. I mean, they'd get drunk on the way and get lost, right? You just wouldn't do it. Yet you let these people vote on who are going, on what the local government is going to do with the resources. I mean, that's madness. You know, that's like letting your neighbor use your fridge. Okay, I mean, that's just, it's just stupid. So, you know, there needs to be a basic validation, which I think is ownership of property or a business. It could be, you know, physical or intellectual property, and then that gives you the right to make reasonable political decisions, the same way that if you want to drive a car, you need a license. I mean, we need a license to drive a car, but you can decide how all the money in the country is going to be spent and let the average alcoholic have the same power as a university professor. That makes zero sense.
Yeah, but how... What do you mean as a practical solution for this disproportion? It is
the practical solution is the ownership of property or the ownership of a business. That is it. That is what was the case in the United States up until about 1880. Now, I'm not saying that we go backwards, but what I am saying is what is good is good. Things with real value, you know, it don't change. You know, your culture might change, your ethics might change, but the fundamental foundational moral principles, like what is written in spiritual and religious texts, that doesn't change. What's good is always good. And so I would go back to you have to own a property or a piece of land or a business. That would be the basic principle. So,
you mean as Chamber of Lords, for example, yeah?
No, because because in the modern society, this is very open. For example, a house, right? If you own a house, you can vote. If your name is on the property for the house, that's a certain level of responsibility. If you can handle that responsibility of property, then you can vote. Or it doesn't have to be a house, it could be a flat, okay? Or it could be that you own a piece of land. To own a piece of land is to be responsible for a part of society. So I would take that. And then there's intellectual property, which is a business. So if you run and own any kind of business, so it would be like I have a Givnost license, so I'm self-employed. So that would give me the right to vote. So I think that should be the fundamental principle, and most people would fall into that category, and you would have to show that you have some level of responsibility, that your name would be on a deed of commerce or property that requires responsibility, because you can't let people with no responsibility decide your future.